increases with the reverse bias voltage, and from this we have calculated the extension ratio of 7 dB for 1 mm long device. And we have also compared our experimentally measured output power with the simulated output power, and we have seen consistency in between them. So in conclusion of my third work, an intensity modulator based on composite waveguide of silicon I2-I2 junction is designed, fabricated and tested. In this work, intensity modulator is a conventional silicon I2-I2 junction exhibited an extension ratio of 7 dB for 1.7 mm long device. So this device of ours was struggling with low of extension ratio and larger device footprint. So in our due to minimal interaction. So to overcome this, in our next contribution, we have seen optical modulation based on distributed silicon I2-I2 junctions. So these are the distributed silicon I2-I2 junctions with gating period of 600 nanometer, gating height of 130 nanometer, and IT on the top is of 50 nanometer. So what is happening is there will be electro-optic coupling of these silicon I2 distributed heterojunction, which will lead to enhanced light matter interaction. The carrier concentration of silicon p-type is 4×10^20 per centimeter cube, and that of ITO is 4×10^20 per centimeter cube. And this is the simulated field propagation along the length. So what actually we mean by coupling of distributed silicon heterojunction? This is a side view of our device. So we can see that there are basically two types of heterojunctions formed here. One is vertical heterojunction and other is horizontal heterojunction. Horizontal heterojunction has been formed between p-type silicon in the grating and n-type ITO in the grating, whereas vertical heterojunction has been formed between p-type silicon in the grating and n-type ITO on the top. On or other way, we can see that n-type ITO in the grating and p-type silicon on the bottom. So let us consider the single heterojunction. So on application of the reverse bias, there will be depletion of the carriers across this junction, that is electrons in ITO and holes in silicon. In both the junctions, we can see there is a depletion of electrons, charge carriers. So when several such distributed heterojunction, that is we have considered single, so when several such heterojunction will be there, are laterally coupled, then it will attain high depletion density, enhanced field and light matter interaction. We can see that in enhanced electric field across the horizontal heterojunction. This spike shows that how along the horizontal heterojunction, the field intensity is increasing with respect to the reverse bias voltage. So this will increase the light matter interaction. Light matter interaction is increasing due to the enhancement of effective tunable area by increasing the junction area where the depletion carriers can be depleted. So we have achieved high depletion density. After this, these are the simulated curves, and after this we have done the computation of modulation and coupling characteristics. So due to the larger depletion density which we achieved in our vertical and horizontal heterojunction, our mode will get affected due to the charge carriers. These are the two-dimensional mode profile at off and on state, that is 0 volt and minus 4 volt. And this is the corresponding effective index change with respect to reverse bias voltage. So our real part is increasing and imaginary part is decreasing. The change in this proposed device, the change in real part of effective index in this device is of order 9×10^-3, and in imaginary part is 1.15×10^-2. Using this change in real part, we have calculated the phase shift length of 86 micrometer using this, and due to the change in imaginary part, we have calculated the extension ratio of 26 dB, which is greater than the one which was reported in conventional silicon I2-I2 junction based intensity modulator. We have also seen eye diagram for output modulated output signal at 35 Gbps, which also shows us extension ratio of 26 dB. And the simulated energy consumption in the proposed device is 36.54 picojoule. So we have achieved the high extension ratio, but as we know that real part of effective index depicts the phase velocity, and the phase velocity is the one which plays the major role for strong optical confinement. So from this graph we can see that our real part of effective index is increasing. So what is happening is our confinement is getting improved, and which is depicted in this graph. So we can see that our coupling efficiency get increased with the increasing reverse bias voltage. At 0 volt it was 34%, and at minus 4 volt it is 66%. So basically our proposed device is exhibiting dual functionality. So one is it is showing intensity modulation with good extension ratio and lower device footprint, and another is it is showing electrically tunable coupling efficiency. So after the modulation, after the computation of modulation and coupling characteristics, we will again do the material processing and analyze the epsilon near zero state in ITO. So again, we have deposited ITO at different oxygen partial pressure in order to vary the carrier concentration. These are the optical images of ITO coated on P-type silicon at different oxygen. Here the oxygen is varied from 1 SSCM to 0 SSCM. And after the deposition, we have calculated the charge carrier density using Hall effect measurement, where we have seen at 0 SSCM we are achieving the highest carrier density. After this, we proceeded towards the electrometry measurement to calculate the optical constants. Then here we can see that the real part of ITO has been plotted against wavelength. From this we can see that with increasing carrier concentration, there is a decrease in permittivity of ITO. And at this particular sample, that is at one deposited at low oxygen partial pressure, the permittivity comes very close to zero, it is approximately 0.7. And this particular sample is exhibiting the epsilon near zero state. This is also verified using this graph that our real and imaginary part of refractive index of ITO in this particular sample is varying with respect to voltage. So we have analyzed the epsilon near zero state. After this, we have proceeded towards the device fabrication. So our device fabrication started with the cleaning of the wafer, and then we have used PMMA A4 electron beam resist over the and spin coated over the substrate. After that, pattern has been transmitted using electron beam lithography. After the patterning and development of the sample, we proceeded for reactive ion etching to achieve the desired etch depth, and then finally electron beam resist was removed. After that, we have deposited the ITO using the deposition parameter which was achieved for the ENZ state, and then finally metallization was done. These are the scanning electron microscopic image of the device, that is top view of the fabricated device, silicon ear plating, and side view of the fabricated device. After the device fabrication, we proceeded towards the optoelectronic measurements. So this is the measurement setup consisting of tunable laser source, single mode fiber, polarization controller, optical spectrum analyzer, device under test, and microscope with electrical probes. So this microscope is used for aligning the probes and the devices. So this input and output single mode fiber are aligned at three different angles, that is 10 degree, 5 degree, and 0 degree with respect to grating normal. And this is the photograph of the electrical and fiber optic probe station used for the device measurement. So from this, we have seen the transmission spectrum at three different angles, that is 10 degree, 5 degree, and 0 degree. And highest transmission of 28 dB is achieved at 1550 nanometer for 10 dB angle of incidence. So as the highest transmission is achieved in this case, we have aligned the fiber at 10 degree and then applied reverse bias using this probe arms. So now this is the major transmission spectrum with respect to the reverse bias voltage at 10 degree angle of incidence with respect to grating normal. So with increasing reverse bias voltage, we can see that our transmittance is getting increased. From this, we have seen the extension ratio of 24.51 dB, which is much close to the one which we have simulated in a numerical. In that, we have achieved the extension ratio of 26 dB. We have also experimentally fitted the transmission versus voltage graph of five different sets of reading. So in this, we are achieving high extension ratio, lower device footprint. It is also acting as a passive coupler with inherent optical coupling, which can be tuned electrically. This particular proposed device is ultra compact and is energy efficient. After this, we have carried out time domain analysis to show the dynamic response of the modulator with a pulse frequency of 300 MHz. From that, we have achieved the rise time and fall time of about 0.12 nanosecond, and thus we can estimate the modulation speed of 8 GHz. We have also carried out the comparison of the performance of the proposed device with state-of-the-art devices with different material and device type. So we have compared our work with lithium niobate, ITO-based MOS type waveguide, monolayer graphene and double layer graphene on silicon-based waveguide, and silicon-based hybrid plasmonic waveguide. So in terms of linear footprint and extension ratio. So in our work, we can see that we have lower device footprint, with high extension ratio. Undoubtedly, hybrid plasmonic wave-based modulator also performs very well in terms of footprint and extension ratio, but hybrid plasmonic wave-based comes with a disadvantage of high optical losses. And apart from this, our device, our work has an edge of dual functionality, that is electrically inbuilt coupling, which can be tuned electrically with a high extension ratio optical modulation. Now, on the summary of this contribution, I would like to say an optical modulator with inbuilt functionality of coupling based on electro-optic coupling of distributed silicon nitro heterojunction is designed, fabricated, and tested, and we have achieved high extension ratio of 24 dB for 80 micrometer long device with an energy consumption of 36 picojoule. So this was all about my silicon nitro heterojunction based optical modulation, that is phase modulation and intensity modulation. Now my last work is on efficient photodetector using sub-band gap transition in distributed silicon nitro heterojunction. So this is the schematic of the proposed device, where we have N-type silicon and silicon air grating is there with a grating period of 600 nanometer, grating height of 150 nanometer, and I2 on the top is of the thickness 100 nanometer. This is the field propagation along the length, and coupled power has been simulated where we can achieve high coupling efficiency of 58%. Then proceeding towards the electronic Venn diagram between N-type ITU and N-type silicon, we can see that it satisfies the criteria of internal photo emission. That is, the Schottky barrier height of 4.45 electron is sufficient for the photo excitation of electrons from ITU for energy greater than the Schottky barrier height, and further these electrons get transported towards the silicon, which will provide us the photo current. So this is a case for single silicon ITU heterojunction, N-type silicon and N-type ITU. So then several such, now we have, what we have done in our devices, we have repetitive periodic heterojunction. So when several such distributed silicon ITU heterojunction will be there along the propagation direction, there will be better control of the absorbed light, which will lead to substantial cumulative photo excitation of the electrons, leading to high responsivity of the device. So moving towards the device fabrication, we have proceeded with the cleaning of paper, and then so we have carried out the spin coating of S1813 photoresist, and in this we have used PicoMaster maskless lithography for the fabrication of the device for transferring the pattern, followed by reactive ion etching to achieve the desired edge depth. And then ITU deposition was carried out for depositing the ITU at 1 SSCM of oxygen partial pressure, 40 SSCM of argon, and then metallization was done. After the device characterization, fabrication, we have proceeded towards the device characterization. This is the schematic of the measurement setup. So at this point, we have compared our photo response of silicon ITU distributed heterojunction with silicon ITU planar heterojunction. In silicon ITU distributed heterojunction, the responsivity is of 0.2, achieved is of 0.2 ampere per watt. Normalized photo current to dark current ratio is 0.052 milliwatt inverse, and quantum efficiency is of 36.48%. Whereas in silicon ITU planar heterojunction, the responsivity achieved is 0.07 ampere per watt with normalized photo current to dark current ratio of 0.01586 milliwatt inverse and quantum efficiency of 16%. So the reason of low responsivity in planar heterojunction is evanescent coupling of the light in planar structure, whereas grating leads to enhanced light matter interaction. Enhanced field in grating leads to better control of the absorbed light, which will lead to better manipulation and detection of the light. After this, we have seen the dynamic response of the photodetector. So this dynamic time response, we can see that the on rise time and fall time is of around 20 nanosecond. And we have also seen the broadband photo response in the proposed device. So acceptably high responsivity of 0.3 ampere per watt to 0.1 ampere per watt has been achieved for 40 nanometer of wavelength. Now we have carried out the performance comparison of silicon-based photodetector at 1550 nanometer with different materials, that is gold on silicon, gold graphene and P-type silicon, gold graphene on silicon, copper on silicon, and compared our work with them. So we can see that we have achieved broadband responsivity is quite good. And but no doubt graphene based plasmonic waveguide have good responsivity than our work, but we are not using any metal in this. This is a metalless photodetector. As we know that plasmonic interaction leads to higher thermionic and optical losses, so we are safe from that, so we have low losses. In summary of this work, I would say an efficient photodetector based on sub-band gap transition in silicon nitride distributed heterojunction is designed, fabricated and tested with a improved photodetector responsivity of 0.2 ampere watt and acceptably high responsivity for a broader wavelength. So this is my thesis conclusion, that is benefiting from this low light electrically tunable permittivity in ITU, efficient phase modulation of guided optical mode in hollow core waveguide has been achieved via carrier injection and depletion. Then an optical modulator based on silicon ITU composite waveguide is designed, fabricated and tested. And low device footprint with a high extension ratio has been achieved by hybridizing silicon and ITU in form of sub-wavelength grating, which we are considering it as distributed silicon ITU hyperjunction. An efficient photodetector based on sub-band gap transition in silicon ITU distributed heterojunction is designed, fabricated and tested. So coming on to our future plan, so as I have told that we have done it as silicon plus photonics. We have done some addition to silicon to overcome the limitation of the silicon. So my next future plan is to increase the coupling by introducing dual layer in electro absorption based modulator. What else is till now I was introduced silicon ITU heterojunction, and as we know that PN or PIN type of structure limits our device speed. So in order to overcome this, the limitation of our device speed, I am tailoring the non-linear property of ENZ materials so that we can realize all optical modulation, in which we do not need any concept of heterojunction or charge carriers. And another thing what we can do is we can design optical limiters, which can be used for beepon technology and all. But this can be done by tailoring the non-linear property of ENZ material. That is, we can tune the absorption of an ITU to our required application. That is, it can be tuned depending upon the incoming laser radiation. So it can also be, so tailoring these properties can also be used in optical limiters. Next, these are my publication from PhD thesis work in referred journals, in referred conferences and award. These are other publications during PhD in referred journals. Other publication during PhD in referred conferences. So coming on to acknowledgement, first and foremost, I would like to sincerely extend my sincere gratitude to my thesis supervisor, Dr. Mukesh Kumar, for his exemplary guidance, constant support and continuous inspiration. I would also like to thank the examiners who spent their valuable time to review my thesis. I also express my heartfelt gratitude to my TSPC member, Dr. Saibal Mukherjee and Dr. Apurva K. Das. I would like to thank my co-supervisor, Dr. Arvind K. Srivastava, to provide partial fabrication facilities at Indus 2 RRK at Indore. I would like to acknowledge the characterization facility of Hybrid Nano Device Research Group, Sophisticated Instrumentation Center, and National Characterization Facility, IIT Indore. I acknowledge the fabrication facility of NRF IIT Delhi, and I gratefully acknowledge the fellowship received towards my PhD from DRDO, MHRD, and SERB. Lastly, I would like to thank all the members of ONRL for their continuous support and help. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Swati. This was great. I would like to invite our external member for this PhD committee, Dr. Srinivas. If you have any questions, please go ahead. Thank you.
Yeah. It's a very nice presentation. Of course, the work is also very good. I have one question, which I already asked in the my report. So you can please elaborate on that. How do you assess the input-output coupling?
In the reported work, in the reported thesis, I have optimized the gating coupler device. I have simulated the efficiency of the gating coupler device, but by incorporating the this input-output coupler in the measurement setup, there is a mode mismatch issue which will lead to lower coupling efficiency as reported in simulation.
Yes. So how much is the overall efficiency?
So overall efficiency was around 33 to 37%.
So the loss is, what is the loss due to?
So one thing is mode mismatch which occurs at input and output both of the couplers.
Yeah, I think that's okay, fine. Yeah, that's all. That's the only question I wanted to ask, even though I had already asked in the my report. Okay, fine. All the best.
Thanks.
Thank you so much, Dr. Srinivas. I would like to request Dr. Aravind to go ahead with his questions, please.
I don't have any question, and I'm very grateful that Swati has used our facility to fabricate these devices, and the device came out to be very good. And that's all I have to say. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Dr. Arman. I would like to now request our PSPC members of Swati, Dr. Shaibul. It was a wonderful presentation. So I think not many people are having questions. And then I would like to ask if somebody has any questions here. No? These are all
students
here, students.
Online
or online.
Just one comment. By you in your future plan, that was future scope, right?
Yeah.
So the plan or the scope which you want to convey to your juniors, right? Yeah, fine. Okay. Yeah.
Thank you so much, Swati. And if there are no questions, I think we can.
I think, can we ask the students?
Students to leave, please. Yeah.
Leave, the online students.